to take a few moments to illustrate that the way you lay out your data, more than anything else, controls the appearance of the chart, more than the choices you might make within the Design tab or the Format tab. Here's what I mean by that assertion that the way you lay out the data affects the way the chart looks. In this data set that I have over here, I've just got the word month and I've got the word cards sold. If I press Alt F1, that'll make a quick chart, and you can see, there it is. But if I change the layout of the data after I just deleted that chart, you might see a subtle difference. In other words, if I take the data that I've been calculating for the first 12 months and I add another one, if then I rank another chart, if I press Alt F1, the chart is a little bit wider. It's got the months of the year, but it's going for 2 years. I'm going to delete that chart as well, and I'm going to take the data that I've been working with and just move it over an extra column, because I wanted to do this. I wanted to type in the words fiscal year at the top of that extra column I've in effect just generated, and I'll put in FY 2019 and go down to the next January and put in FY 2020, and I'll put a space between the FY and the 2019 so it's consistent. But the difference now in that I kind of moved the data to the side and added an extra column is that when I press Alt F1, there's going to be someone who's wondering, how is it that you created those two individual subheadings below the main months that appear above them? And the answer to that question is, well, the way you lay out the data affects the way the chart looks. I'm going to delete that chart once more and explain that if I take that fiscal year 2019 and I just paste it into that column and then move this data off to the side and then take this title, copy that and paste it up here, this is a totally uncharacteristic method of organizing a spreadsheet. It is breaking all those guidelines of don't skip rows, don't skip columns, but the purpose of it is to illustrate that if I press Alt F1, the way that the data is laid out influences the way the chart looks. And I've got these two subheadings, and each of these series is represented by a different color because they're in a different column. I don't need that legend. Everyone knows one is fiscal year 2019 and fiscal year 2020. But the theme of this is the way the data is laid out affects the way the chart looks. As an illustration of this, I wanted to show you a finished model and then how to create it. This is what someone would call a dial chart. But as soon as I click it, you're noticing there is no dial chart. This is a donut chart, and the data is laid out in such a way that it makes it possible to show a needle that reflects the value that's in the cell next to the word value. Let me show you that I have a spinner that I put onto this screen that changes the value that's in this cell that's next to the word value that influences this column of numbers here. But putting in the numbers 60, 60, 60, and then 180 is what in effect creates these three sections that you could color, these three different slices. And the needle is represented by these numbers here. How do you do that? Well, let me explain. If I highlight this data and then I choose Insert and then I choose a donut chart, this is the donut chart. But it doesn't necessarily look finished until you fix it. And what I mean by that is I'm going to click on that, and then I'm going to bring up the Format menu. Because the first thing I need to do, and maybe this will help you understand what I'm doing, is I'm going to change the angle of the first slice to 270 degrees. By doing so, it rotates this the way I need it to be rotated. The second thing I'm going to be doing is limiting the size of the donut hole by changing the slider next to donut hole size. Now it's getting a little bit more like what I need. But then you go to each of these different slices, like this one, and you're going to choose under the Home tab, that's one way to do it, to make this have no fill. And then this other slice that's at the bottom of the outer circle is going to have no fill. Neither is this one going to have no fill. This is going to have no fill. And as you're watching, I am gradually pulling apart this chart and only showing what it is that I need to display. As I make this bigger, let's just change the size, you can see that the slice is getting larger. I don't need the legend, so I'll press delete. And then this becomes the needle, that one data point there that I'm going to fill in with a darker color. I'll make it, well, that's if I can click that needle successfully. Let me undo what I just did. Let's hit the undo, or I'll just change the color to empty. Maybe that's an easier approach. And then carefully select that individual data point that's orange, and maybe I'll use this to make it a black needle. And then, of course, maybe I'm going to add a data label to that, so I'll press the right mouse button and choose where it has add a data label. And when I choose add a data label, it's going to somehow put a little label on this right over there, if I can carefully move this off to the side. But you see that label is actually reflecting that second number, but it should actually reflect the larger number because that's where it is on the dial. So you select that box, and just like I did earlier in changing the title, I'm going to go up and edit that by clicking on the formula bar, typing equals, and linking it to that cell. So even though that data point is actually represented in my numbers area as a 2, it's actually showing the number 62 because that's the value that is controlled by the slicer. And so that's how you begin to make that type of a dial chart, but it answers the question or illustrates the point: the way the data is laid out affects the way the chart looks. Here's another example. This is a Gantt chart. And this Gantt chart that you see here, if I change the actual start date to be a 2-day duration, you notice that it shows and increments the size of these bars here to be larger. If I reduce the overall duration of the project by reducing the duration of one of those phases, then again, it becomes a shorter time span. But if I click on this, you can tell that this is nothing more than a stacked bar chart that I've just been able to format to conceal the other parts of the screen. Let me move this out of the way and show you what I mean. If I highlight this data that I've laid out in this fashion, and then I choose Insert, and then I choose underneath the chart menu, I'll choose a bar chart here if I can find one carefully enough. When I choose that bar chart, I'm going to choose the stacked version of the bar chart, and then I'm going to click OK. Now, admittedly, this doesn't look like the finished product yet, but it will as I format it. Because among the things I'm going to do is I'm going to want that series to go in the reverse order. So by choosing the appropriate choice for this axis, I can put it in the reverse order. And then I can also choose to put this at the maximum versus the minimum value. So I'll put this at the, let's see if I do this correctly. If I choose this choice and I can have it be at the maximum, then the dates go along the bottom. If the dates do go along the bottom, it certainly doesn't seem practical to show these bars. So I cannot show them, but I also can't delete them. So my intention is to use the fill pattern again, to choose to fill them with nothing, and then change the time scale of the axis along the bottom. I can do that if I knew what date March the 9th was. So I'll press Control and the accent grave to show you that it's number 41342. And then press Control and that accent grave key again to make it go away. I'll choose this axis and I'll change the minimum number to 41342. That's the actual representation of whatever Friday the 15th is. And because I know this is a 30-day duration, well, then I'll change the maximum number to 41372. And by changing those numbers, I've effectively expanded the width of this. And if I reduce the gap width, it starts to look thicker, and it starts to look more like the original chart that I began with, oh, I know you can change this, because you can change the major units from 5 to 7, so it's more like 1 week at a time, and there are the dates that you're seeing. That's how you change an existing data set into a Gantt chart. And I'll leave it to you to add a new title.